that's got coming up, I encourage you to check out his website, his TED Talk on Human 2.0. And I'm very excited to have you all get to know the man that I've been starting to get to know over the last few months. So put your hands together for Branson.
Thank you. So I'm a professor, and accordingly, my talks are usually 10 hours long. But fortunately for you guys, I also speak very, very fast. So the thing is, I always prepare my talk, and then I ask the people I speak to how long I'm supposed to speak. And if they say it's 1 hour, I just speed it up by 10 times. If it's a 15-minute TED talk, I just speed it up by 20 times. So the talk is already ready. I just have to figure out how fast to speak to you guys. So accordingly, you're going to be responsible for raising your hand every time you think I speak way too fast. Let's try to channel everyone. You all get to slow me down, but if really, you're going to be the voice of everyone else. So I prepared a bunch of slides that I'm going to show you, but I also want to semi-improvise and use the next half an hour, 40 minutes, to tell you why a person with my background gets to even speak to you guys. So my background is in neuroscience. I spent the last 12 years studying the brain. And the main way I do it, I'm gonna tell you about in a second, but generally what I care about for most of my career is understanding how thinking works inside the brain, how emotions work inside the brain, how memories get stored. Things that I didn't know would be of interest to anyone outside of neuroscientists trying to understand how people think, feel, behave, and so on. But about 3 years ago, I was approached by a business school, Kellogg, and they said, there is an interest in your field in how we can translate the knowledge from neuroscience to the business world and to help people understand how decisions are being made, how emotions affect our choices, how traders can actually use intuitions better, and so on. So the reason I made this decision 3 years ago is because there's more and more interest in using the knowledge from neuroscience in business. So what I want to do today is I want to convince you first that there is a need for all of you guys to be somewhat aware of neuroscience and to kind of keep your finger on the pulse so that you will be aware of the developments that we kind of come up with every couple of months, because I think they're going to be useful in your career. And I want to also tell you about one or two different things that we do right now that is helpful to you both in the world of learning and also in behavior change. And I'm going to use basically the two speakers before me talking about AI, talking about basically understanding performance, to combine it to tell you how neuroscientists think about that and how we can use that to really change some things going forward, so you're not just locked inside your brain as is, but you can actually do things to change whatever doesn't work. And I'm going to do one ambitious thing. I'm going to try to be inspiring towards the end and use the fact that I have an audience that I don't normally get to speak to tell you how I think you should also use this work going forward to make the world a better place. So that's my plan for the next 30 minutes. Okay, so I'm going to start about 10 minutes convincing you that neuroscience is important to understand behavior, and then I'm going to take that to the things that we do right now. The brain sits here at the head. There's a mapping of one-to-one between humans and brains. This is actually how brains look. This is a real brain of a person who recently died just before the picture was taken. A brain is about the size of two fists, so much smaller than we think it is. It doesn't really feel the skull, it's much smaller. It actually sits in a room that's pretty dark. There's no light inside the head. It's liquidy, kind of cold, a little bit cooler, and it takes a lot of energy to operate this thing. And yet, all of our desires, our emotions, our beliefs, our and ecstasy and agony sit in these 3 pounds and drive who we are. And the way I apply my knowledge in neuroscience to what you would care about, I think, is by trying to explain this moment. So the idea is that there's a moment that you all encounter every now and then. You're going to the supermarket, let's say, you're trying to buy a toothpaste, there's Colgate on the left, Crest left, Crest on the right, and you have to make a choice, and now something happened to your brain. And ultimately, there's a complex mechanism that kind of drives what you do, and then you make a choice. And the question is, can we explain, predict, and even change what you're going to choose? And can you, if I ask you? And if so, what elements of this choice can be attributed to something that we can understand by looking at your brain precisely versus all kinds of things outside of the environment? Okay, so many companies recently have realized that neuroscientists are useful to their work. These are just a list of big ones that I got to work with. You see that the both Republican and Democrats are really interested in that because the idea that our personality somehow leads to our voting is really key now to how they think they can change behavior. And generally, the field of neuroscience in business sits somewhere in the mix between psychology, economics, and neuroscience. Somewhere here lies this field called consumer neuroscience that basically says, let's take understanding of the brain, let's take understanding of psychology, let's take mathematics or economics and combine them to understand how people behave, how they make decisions. And ultimately, they try to explain the gap that good businesses know between how we explain our behavior and how we actually think in our brain. And there's two reasons that neuroscientists like myself were recruited by a lot of companies to help them understand customers, and that is because customers often are not really good in explaining or articulating how they make decisions. So if you ask your customers why they did what they did, they're going to give you an answer. There's going to always be an answer, it's just that many times the answer is unaligned with everything that we see that they are governing their choices by. And there are two types of lies that I got to experience that I like to frame them as the two industries that reflected them the most when I worked with them. One industry was the organic food industry, and one was the pornography industry. And those are very different industries. None of them common, but when I was living in Los Angeles, I got to learn a little bit about both. First, organic food. I lived in Los Angeles in a zip code 90036, small zip code in West Hollywood, where it happens to be where a lot of Hollywood stars live. And as you may imagine, they eat very healthy and go to the gym a lot. And accordingly, in this tiny zip code, there are about six supermarkets that are all very, very healthy. Beyond Whole Foods and Trader Joe's, there were like small supermarkets that no one knew of that all served very, very healthy food. And at some point, there was a survey circulating in the zip code that said, we're going to open another one, a seventh supermarket that's going to do even better job in serving organic food. This one is going to have cows that will milk from mothers. Everything is going to be infused with gold. And that's going to be how good the food there is. If we open a supermarket and it costs even more than the others, will you buy the food there? Survey circulates, they get the results, and the results were something that in marketing we teach students is remarkable. About 90% of people said yes. So really, really, everyone said, if you open a supermarket, you're going to buy there. So a really good survey, everyone says, if you get this result, you open a supermarket. So they did. They opened a supermarket in this zip code, and about a year after, they had to close because no one actually bought there. So somehow, at the end of the day, when people came to the supermarket and they saw the milk that cost $20, they said, that's ridiculous. Yes, milk coming from mouths, but come on, I want just regular 2%, I'm going to buy it in Whole Foods, all the expensive. So the idea is that somehow people answer the survey predicting that they're going to do something, but when it came to the moment of choice, they didn't do it. People didn't lie. They just didn't know who they're going to be a year ahead. And this is all of us. We buy jeans for a skinny version of ourselves. If you look at the December 31st searches on Google, you see that people search for gym memberships a lot more. There's like a spike in people looking for gyms. There's actually a gym in Los Angeles that offers you a service where you come to the gym, and you buy membership for, I think, let's say $800, and you pay up front, and every time you show up, they give you $2 back. So if you show up the entire year, you actually make money. And obviously, they make a lot of money, because people really believe that they're going to be there every day, but somehow, as the year progresses, kind of you find reasons why not to. So we all have this idea that we're going to be better some other time in the future. We make predictions about that, and it doesn't align with our behavior as we live our lives. These are lies that are not really lies in the sense that you lie to me, but you lie to yourself. You tell yourself something that you're not, and then if I'm a marketing person, I ask you a question, if I try to understand the customers, I will get an answer in a survey. But it just won't reflect the behavior that comes later, because we don't really know who we are, and therefore neuroscience maybe would be the best answer, because look at the brain when you answer the question, and will give you something about the dissonance between what you are and what you want to be. Pornography was a different world. When I was at Caltech, we had a little survey. This was the time of net neutrality. We were trying to understand how people use the internet. And we had a little survey where we asked people, about 1,000 undergrads, how often do you watch porn on your computer? And the answer was never. Out of 1,000 people, if we asked, only one person watched porn ever in his life, or her life. And that's surprising because it's like about 12% of the graduates is internet porn. We know that. So it's clearly this one guy who is awake all the time. Or probably because they don't answer. Now, in the world of marketing, if you're, of course, asking questions that people find embarrassing, you will get just a lie. And this isn't just porn, it's true for healthcare. A lot of times we ask people about things that they don't like to answer, about habits that we're not proud of, or about even eating habits, or the things that we don't align. And that's, again, a moment where if you ask questions, you're going to get an answer. It's just that you not necessarily you can't necessarily trust the answer. That's why you want some other method to at least tell you that the answer you got isn't purely correct, and you have to do something else. That's where neuroscientists like myself enter. And what's behind that is something that I'm going to start with, I'm going to say right now, but I also want to end with, because it's the most profound idea that I want to share with you today. And that is that we don't really know what's going on in our brain, and the more we dig into our brain and try to understand how it works, we realize that actually there's probably someone else inside our head that drives this wagon, but we don't really understand how she or he think. And all we do is come after the fact when actions were made and come up with a narrative that explains them. So most of what our brain does is it takes things that happened recently to us and comes up with a story that explains why we did what we did and tries to align it with a lot of stories that we had before. We call this mechanism consciousness, we call it narrative, we call it life. Life is taking a lot of events and weaving them into a story. This is everyone's experience when they apply for college, right? You're asked to write why you want to be a doctor, and you say, all my life, I want to be a doctor. And you come up with like a story at your grandmother and some event that you've seen. We try to do that. We all do that consciously when we apply for schools, but also all the time in our brain. We kind of come up with a story. Now, it was hard for me to grasp that as a scientist in the last 20 years. It is also hard for me to understand it day to day when I think about behavior. And I'm going to end by telling you how I do find a way to kind of grapple with this idea. But the first time I encountered this idea and kind of came up with some example that allows me to see how the world is in that sense, when I was about 6 years old, back in Israel, playing computer games. So I was a kid in the 80s. In the 80s, computers were really expensive, so the only way to play computer games was to go to a video game store, a arcade store, where there was like big machines, and you played games on a big, expensive devices. And I was a fan of this game that some of you may know, Donkey Kong. You play this Italian plumber. You have this beloved princess sitting, where is she? This is the princess. That is your official desire. But there's a big gorilla who kidnapped her and throws barrels at you as you try to climb up and save your beloved princess. So this is the game, pretty simple. I, as a 7-year-old, let's say, or an 8-year-old, played this game pretty well for about 30 seconds in the video game store until two words appeared on the screen that changed my entire view of control. The two words were insert coin. After that point, I was not playing the game. I was watching a movie, a demo of the game playing itself. And after 30 seconds, the words flashed to say, hey, now if you want to play this game, you can actually insert coin and play yourself. So up to that point, I was just watching a video of a character moving around, but I felt I was in control. This is because my motive were aligned with the character's motive. I wanted to go up, so I moved just in the right direction. The character moved right. Granted, there were moments probably when I tried to move right, and the character moved left, or I tried to jump, and didn't jump. But because most of the time, reality aligned with my interest, I was able to tell myself a story that I'm in control. Only when I was faced with those two words and I had to really understand what's going on, did I say, oh, now I understand. I was just watching a movie. And this is the analogy I have for you about life. This is kind of how life works in our brain. Most of the time, there's this character moving around, and we come afterwards quickly and narrate that story and come up with an answer. Now, this means that whatever happens in your brain is happening, and you, after the fact, kind of come up with an answer. And it also means that you can't really be certain that thoughts in your brain are something that you put there correctly. Like maybe things happen that you can't explain, and you just really come up with an answer afterwards that you're not really sure was the answer that your brain wanted. You really come up with a story that wasn't the story that the person who made a choice actually made. Now, this is something that is really help us to understand. Like, we kind of all have the idea that, yes, someone can tell me something I don't believe and I can reject that. We all talk about the world of different versions of reality. Someone tells you something, you say, no, I don't like this answer, so this is a fake fact, and something that aligns with what I say, I like it, it's a true fact. But we never have doubts about our own facts in the brain. Like, once I put it in, I think it's facts. For instance, right now it's about 4 p.m., you're all sitting here with me and you're listening to me. Tomorrow, if you have dinner with your friends and they ask, where were you last afternoon yesterday? You say, oh, I was in this lecture. And someone said, no, you were with me playing tennis in the area. And you say, no, I remember clearly, I was in the hotel listening to the lecture. And I said, no, you were with me playing tennis. Here's a video of us playing tennis. Here's a picture of you playing tennis. Here's 10 people who all were there playing tennis. It's going to take you a lot of time before you say, you know what, maybe I'm wrong. Like, you would be certain, because we trust our brain so much that there's no moment where we say, you know what, I'm not sure that what I think is true is true. You kind of trust your brain entirely. This is what led my students to create this t-shirt that says, don't believe everything you think, which is a profound idea, it's a joke, but a profound idea that we have to kind of start understanding that in our own brain, we don't really know what's going on entirely, and we mostly just come up with stories. Okay, I told you that, but you want me to convince you, so let me show you an example or two of the fact in our brain that actually are multiple people living together, and every time they make a choice, Colgate versus Crest, they actually compete. They argue, they vie for dominance, and in the end they may have a vote, and the vote is reached, and that's only then when you get exposed to the answer and you make the decision, so to speak. Not knowing that there were all kinds of voices in your head that were trying to kind of come up with different answers. So I'm saying that, but in order to convince you, I'm going to show you one example that is, I think, really important, of people who actually get to expose the multiple facets of their reality outside. So for most of you, there's people in your head that buy for dominance, but you don't really know, because you only see the bottom line, the vote, and you think this was your reality. But some people actually have situations where their brain gets to give voice to the other things. For instance, this guy. So in the 60s, people who had epilepsy had a unique way to treat the epilepsy. If you know, epilepsy is a disorder in which part of your brain, let's say somewhere here, starts speaking without any provocation. For no reason, it starts speaking, and because the brain does not do that, it starts answering, and before long, everything in the brain kind of goes into speaking in a sound of cacophony in your head, which translates behaviorally to you losing consciousness, falling down, maybe if you have a baby, dropping your baby, or if you're in a car, having an accident. So it's a really risky behavior, and what doctors try to do is mostly temper the activity in your brain by giving you medicine that will kind of reduce the activity. But in the 60s, one of the solutions that people had as an idea was not to actually drop medication, not to stop the activity by using medicine, but actually realizing the fact that the brain has two hemispheres, two sides, that are connected by a bridge, to cut the bridge. So the idea of this surgery in the 60s was that if you cut the bridge, then whatever place in the brain starts the seizure is going to be contained. The seizure is going to start, spread, but there won't be any way for you to go to the other side, so you'll have half your brain to still hold you together. And this is extreme, of course, but it worked. For a lot of patients, you just cut the corpus callosum in a very kind of relatively simple surgery, and then when they had a seizure, they still had, you know, half their body to hold, or the wheel, or to press the brake, or to do something to kind of stop themselves from having injuring themselves or others. Now, it turns out that in our brain, most of the time, most things in our brain are symmetrical. So if you actually cut the bridge, you still have half the brain to do things correctly. So, and it's kind of a simple symmetry, so the right side of the brain controls everything on the left, and the left side of the brain controls everything on the right. So if you wink with your right eye, this happens by controlling it from the left side of the brain. If you raise your right arm, the left side of the brain did it. If you raise your left arm, the right side of the brain control it, and so on. Pretty easy. What happens with things that you only have one of? Like your language. You only have one mouth. What happens there? When you have one, in that case, a situation where the brain just chose a location. Nature just gave a part of the brain this control. So language comes from the left, and that's it. There's no symmetry there. So in this example that you're going to see here right now, there's a guy who is a split brain patient. One of those guys whose brain was cut in half. And he's asked to play a game where he sees this little puzzle here, he gets four cubes and he's asked to organize the cubes in the shape of the puzzle. When he has it in his left hand, there's no problem. Because the left hand speaks the right side of the brain, where you have the control of puzzle solving. No problem, does it right away. When he's asked to do the same thing with his right arm, he has a problem. because the right arm only speaks to the left side of the brain, but you don't have this thing that solves puzzle, so he just sits there, the same person, and struggling to solve the puzzle. Now, but you see exactly that the left hand actually knows the answer, right? It knows how to solve it, so it wants to help its friend on the right. So if you let the guy use his both his hands, what you see is that the hands actually vie for dominance. They compete because this guy has two counters in his brain, and the one no and one doesn't try to solve a problem. And this is what's happening in our brain all the time. It's just we don't see it. All the time we have those in our brain, it's just that they get resolved under the hood and we get to see them afterwards and come up with an answer. Yeah, I always wanted to do that. Why is it important? Because now we can actually demonstrate that and also show you how we can come between and nudge you in one or other direction and help you behave differently. Okay, so to demonstrate that it's not just cases like people with split brain, but it could be any of us. We ran this study long ago that now we're trying to replicate in an even stronger way, where we try to show that, in fact, even people in this room could have a gap between the person who decides and the person who explains the choices a little bit after. So in this study, we brought people to the lab. Let's say you're the person. You come to the lab. We have a person who sits in front of you, and he pulls two cards with pictures of two men, and then he asks you a simple question that doesn't seem like very, very important because you don't know any of them. Who do you find more attractive, the guy on the left or the guy on the right? Left. Plastic. So you say left, and then he gives you the card that you said is the one you chose, and then he asks you in one sentence to explain why you picked this guy.
Looks closer to my age.
Looks closer to your age. Fantastic, that's a good answer. We say, good, let's pick two new cards with two different men. Again, you don't know any of them, they don't mean anything to you. Two new options, make a choice, you choose the one on the left, we give you the card, you explain why. You do it for about half an hour. Half an hour, keep choosing a person from two options and making us, telling us why. From your perspective, this is a study. From ours, there's a little trick here that actually makes it more interesting. Because in about one in every 20 trials, the guy who gives you the card, who's a magician that we hired, hands you the card he didn't pick. So you chose this guy, he says great, and he gives you this guy. And then two interesting things happen. First, people rarely notice. So most of the time people say, I want A, we give them B, they take B. But here's the more interesting part. They then go on and explain to us why they chose B. Right? You chose Colgate, I give you Crest, and you say, I always wanted Crest because of so-and-so. Now this isn't just like, so it only works in cases that are trivial like this, where you don't really have a lot of choices, where you don't really know any of the people, where they don't mean a lot to you. It's gonna be hard for you to confuse your wife with someone else, hopefully. But many things in life, the choices are like that. Most of the time, we make simple choices that we don't care about. You go to the restaurant, you ask for one thing, if you didn't pay attention, they give you something else, you don't really know this way. Were there a cilantro there or not? I'm not sure that I wanted it or not. And the thing is, think about it in the business world, right? You go to the supermarket with a list of things that you want to buy, and you get the toothpaste part, and you say, okay, there's a Colgate here, Crest, I'm going to choose the Crest because I want that, you put it in the basket, and you keep shopping, and I go into your basket at some point between the moment you chose and the moment you get the checkout, and I sneak in and I replace the Colgate with the Crest. Most times you're going to just buy whatever you got. And if I stop in the way outside and I say, focus group, I want to interview you for a topography survey about why you chose what you chose, you're going to give me an answer. And the more I ask you and probe, the more the web of answers is going to be integrated in your brain. You're going to come up with more and more explanations, and you're going to start believing it. If you just chose it without really caring, you would stop there. But if I start saying, you know, people mostly say that Colgate is this, why did you choose Crest? And you're going to say, well, I actually don't really know. You're going to come up with answers that will actually make your brain create more and more associations for the choice you have not made, and really start defending it. And this means that if this 5-second gap between the choice being made and us defending it is wide enough, we can ask questions like, who is me? And also, if that's the case, like, kind of, what does it matter to make a choice? And if so, can we change things to the point that we can actually change our behavior? Okay, so this was how I wanted to open. Now I want to skip straight to where I was going to. and tell you why the brain is the place to look into those questions. So up to now, we spoke about the fact that we don't really know who we are, and that there are potentially moments where there's a gap between how we behave and what our brain wanted. But I didn't really convince you yet that the brain is where you should look to understand behavior. So now I'm going to tell you two stories, short stories, that will hopefully convince you that looking at the brain is paramount to understanding what you do and how to predict what you do. And these stories are of extreme cases where people had changes happen to their brain that led to changing their behavior. This guy, judging by the age in the room, none of you remembers this story, but maybe some of you heard about it in passing. This guy, Charles Whitman's in this picture in the cover of Time, became famous in 1966 when he took a cab from his apartment in Austin, Texas, and drove to the University of Austin, where he climbed the tallest tower at the university, looking above the entire grounds, and then he pulled an AK-47 and started spraying people from above, killing 14 by the way. Then he waited for the ambulance to come and help those that were injured or hurt, and then he reloaded his rifle and shot the people who came to help them. In the course of the next 50 minutes, he sat there and he kept firing at whoever came to help people who were injured until the police was able to climb up the tower and shoot him dead. This was the first of what we know now as an almost weekly event where someone out of nowhere goes and starts killing people. And because it was such a horrific event that no one saw coming before, it open up for the first time the idea of like, should people own guns, and what does it mean to have a weapon? It's the first time that we had something like this, so we got a lot of attention. And also the police wanted to kind of expand this story by investigating the background of Charles Whitman. So they went to his neighborhood and they asked his friends and his neighbors about him. And like a regular person that ends up in a very horrific situation, there were no signs prior. Charles Whitman's friend said he was a great friend, he was a great neighbor, he was discharged honorably from the Marines a year before. Everything about this guy seemed normal. They went to his apartment, everything was nicely color-coded and folded, and nothing about this guy indicated that something like that would happen, until they found his diary. So buried under his bed, there was a meticulously written diary that he kept for the months ahead, leading to this event, where he wrote about his thoughts. And he writes there that he feels he's not himself. He says, I'm not okay, I have awful thoughts. He actually goes to a psychiatrist and checks himself to actually get medicine, which doesn't help him, because the night before the killing, he writes, I have these awful thoughts in my mind, I'm worried about myself and about others, and I'm worried I'm gonna do something bad. And if I end up doing something bad and hurting people, or myself, and ending up dead, I ask that whoever finds me, open my brain and look inside, because something's not right. And he even gives a check for $10,000 for this to be done. So they do that. They open his brain and look inside. What they see is a massive tumor, pressing on a part of the brain, right at the heart of who you are, called the amygdala, that has to do with fear and anger and aggression, and may or may not have led to this behavior. We can't know. But here's something we can know, a story that is even more interesting. It happened 8 years ago in San Diego. When a woman calls the police and says, my husband that I've been married to for the last 10 years, and we had a perfectly normal sex life, up to a few months ago, turned into a pedophile. My husband is a pedophile, and I'm worried about our 4-year-old daughter. You've got to come and arrest my husband. And the police comes, and they look in his house, and they find child pornography in his computer, and they arrest him, and he goes to trial. And on the first day of the trial, he complains about a headache, and they ignore it. And on the second day, he complains about a headache, and they ignore it. And the third day, he has a seizure in the courthouse. So they rush him straight to the emergency room where a neurologist looks at his brain, and what they see in the scan is, again, a massive tumor pressing on the left front part of his brain that should have caused him pain and other disorders, but he did not. But it definitely is a risk for his life, so they send him straight from the ER to the operating room where a surgeon removes the tumor in a 12-hour surgery, and when he wakes up, he has no tumor in his brain, but also, he is no longer a pedophile. He said, I have no idea what happened to me, I'm not myself, this is embarrassing, I don't know who this guy was, but I'm guilty as it can get, and I really feel sorry for what I did. And in a very, very unprecedented ruling, the judge in his case actually sends him a call. And she says in her ruling that it wasn't his fault, it was his brain's fault. Which is a philosophical idea that we can talk about afterwards. What does it mean to have something that's not your fault, but your brain's fault? But he gets home free on probation. And this story is already interesting in itself, but it actually is a twist. It makes it even more interesting. Because 10 months later, the wife calls again and says, my husband had a bit of fat again. You've got to do something about it. And they look at him the second time, and they see that some of the tumor actually metastasized and grew back, and it's pressing on the same part of your brain, so they can go to a second surgery, and then he goes back to his normal behavior. This is like a controlled experiment, right? You have it one way, you behave one way, you take it out, you behave differently, you bring it back, you behave the same way. It's a perfect example of something that we neuroscientists always understand, which is small changes to your brain can change your entire personality. And it happens regardless of what you want. Like, none of those people wanted to be who they ended up being. It just happens, and you explain your behavior after the fact. And we have to go as far as to people like these two, who actually became very, very uniquely evil compared to what they thought they should be. We can think about you. In about 20 minutes, we're going to have a reception here. All of you are going to pour some ethanol on your mucosal glands. And suddenly everything is going to become different, funnier, we all know those moments where something small happens and an entire personality changes. And for the first time in history, neuroscientists can actually tap into your brain and see who you really are, so to speak, and understand how to work with that. Not only that, they can also look at your brain and see what needs to be changed so you can become a better version of yourself. So here's a list of tools that we use. We're looking at the brain using electrodes that sit on the surface of the skull and try to predict something about your identity by just looking on the outside. Sometimes we put your entire brain in a big magnetic field and we inject magnetic fields through it and try to see what gets absorbed to understand somehow how you think. Or we can even look at things that are more simple, like where your eyes go, or how your facial muscles code your expression and your emotions, or even how much arousal you feel when you see something scary or something exciting in your skin conductance to understand who you are. All of those are small changes that actually tell us enough about who you are. Ultimately, if you want to understand the brain really in the best way, you should actually open one and look inside. This is, of course, something that we can't really... I mean, actually, I'm here looking for volunteers. most neuroscientists work with animals, where they actually open their brain and stick electrodes inside their head and listen to the activity of brain cells to understand how we think. With humans, we can't do any of that, so we resolve those methods. And here is where I buy to you right away, because it's actually what we do for the last 10 years. So what I wanted to show you is one unique work that we've been involved in the last 12 years that actually does what I just said is almost impossible, which is open the brains of humans and put electrodes inside, not animals, humans, and understand how their brain processes information. So these are not people like you and I, in the sense that they're not sitting in a lab experiment. They actually are patients who undergo brain surgery for clinical purposes. So some patients who have a disorder that is very uniquely located in part of the brain, need a surgery that will help us understand where this focus is and figure out what to do about it. So imagine the epilepsy that I mentioned earlier. If you have epilepsy and you don't respond well to medications, the only solution that we can offer you is to actually find the location in the brain that starts and triggers the seizure and take it out. Remove a section of your brain and then actually make you go seizure-free for the rest of your life. Not medication, you're fixed. In order to do that, we have to actually figure out the amount of brain that we can take out that's the smallest around the faulty part of your brain. And for that, we have to really, really be able to zoom in on the location. And what we do with that is we bring patients to the hospital and we open their brain and stick microphone electrodes deep inside their head, surrounding the area that we suspect the seizure onsets are. And then we connect those wires to a computer and we wait. We wait a few days, sometimes weeks, sometimes up to a month. And we hope that in the course of those days, the patient's gonna have a seizure. This time we want to have a seizure because now with the electrodes inside our brain, we can actually trace the seizure floating in their brain to the onset. We can figure out exactly where it began. We have them have a few seizures in the operating room until we know exactly where it started, then we take the wires out, we reset the damaged part of the brain, we close everything, and they walk away seizure-free. This is the procedure clinically. What we also do is science. We also say, you know what? You're here for the next 3 weeks waiting to have seizures. You're only sitting in bed, you can't really move much because your head's connected to a computer. You're gonna watch movies with a book, talk to your friends, but you can't really move much. But since you're here and you're waiting to have seizures and you have wires in your brain, do you mind also letting me ask you a question about Colgate versus Crest? and see how you think about choices. And patients are always happy to participate, and this allows us to actually get access to the most, the golden part of science. Looking inside the brains of a human with microphones that understand the activity of individual cells and see our thoughts in action. Here's how it looks. Here is the setup. You go inside the brain. You put microphones that eavesdrop on the activity of cells, and those cells speak the language that we translate to something like that. What you hear now, those spikes, those burst of activity, is one cell speaking to another and telling it, I care about something in the world. Each cell speaks in this language. It doesn't come out as sound. It comes out as an electrical activity, but we translate it to sound. But the point is that you hear those spikes, when you hear those burst of activity, it means that one cell tells another, something interesting happens. And if we can know what happened in the real world that made those cells fire, we can actually know what these cells code. So what we do, if you don't like brains, look away for a second, is put electrodes inside the brain, wrap it up, take wires from the brain into a computer, and have the patient sit in front of a laptop and watch a movie or look at items that we care about while we look at the brain and listen to the cells speak and try to find some cells that come to life when something interesting happens. Here's an example. Here's a patient
to the crazy ones.
Watching clips of movies here. And what you hear is the sound of one cell in this woman's brain. Try to figure out what this cell codes, what this cell correlates with, what it cares about. Unicorns, democracy, economics, man, dead, love, everything that you can name has a cluster of cells that come to life when you think them. In fact, this is a thought. A thought is a set of those cells coming to life. And we know that because we can actually have you close your eyes and just think something, and we can still decode your thoughts. We didn't do this patient. We came to her afterwards and said, okay, now in the morning you've seen all kinds of clips, now it's the afternoon. We ask you to just sit in bed and recall the things that you've seen in the morning. Tell us what you've seen earlier on. What you're gonna see now is that when she remembers the Simpsons, the same cells fire. In fact, they fire seconds before she speaks. We can see her thoughts coming to her. So now we saw something remarkable. Not only did we see her thoughts coming to her, we also saw how far before she knows them can we tell them. About 2 seconds. Which means that most of life already happened when we experienced it. When I speak to you right now, I feel that everything I say happens in real time. But the reality is that I'm also listening to my brain, as you do, just that I feel agency and ownership because it came from my mouth. But at some point in my brain, someone sat there and planned the next verb, the next word, the next, everything happened, and it just came out of me, and I say, oh, I wanted to say it. Which means that we can now start looking at the gap between planning, thinking, and experiencing in the brain, and A, predict what you're gonna do in the future, but B, come in between and change things. So of course we can do cool things like project your thoughts on a screen, or see how you think about things and how you perceive them, but you can also see the gap between the moment you perceive something and the moment your brain perceives it, and also what stops you. So here's an experiment we're gonna do right now. I'm gonna show you a picture. Here's a picture. You see this picture? It's flashing in front of your eyes and I'm telling you already your brain sees a problem here. Your brain has a problem with this picture. You don't know the problem yet, but I and your brain already know it. The problem is that there are actually two pictures here, and they alternate. And there's one thing that changes between those pictures. Don't say it yet, but if you see it right away. Now, I can tell you that your brain only sees it. Your brain sees immediately that there's something there, and it's gone. There and it's gone. You have 1, 2, 3. A few people see it. Now, if you don't see it, you get also nervous right now. It's like this very early. You start scanning it from like left to right. Okay, maybe it's the sky, maybe it's the beret, maybe it's the Canada flag, the shadow. How many soldiers are there here? How many windows? You really get nervous right now. How many of you see it already? Okay, it's right here at the center. There's the engine. So right in front of your eyes at the center of the picture was an item that's pretty big that kept disappearing. And your brain has cells that code engines, and they were firing and not. Firing and not. But somehow they didn't tell you what they said. And again, you can ask the question, who is me? Like, why is my brain knowing things and not sharing it with me? Why all this wasteful energy to find something that I don't get to know? Here's another example. If you felt smart in the first one, you get a chance to feel stupid in the second one. Raise your hand and you see it. Twice. It correlates with IQ, by the way. It has no better ending, it's pure luck. Okay, I'll tell you, it's right here. The cool thing about it is that this is learning in action, because now for the rest of your life you cannot see it anymore. But from then on, if you see it ever in your life, you will know it. So you just had a learning experience. Okay, why is it cool? Because we can, of course, see what your brain is seeing, but we can also start using them to kind of predict your choices before you know them. So here's an example. We can have you play a little game, and look at your brain, and you're about to make a choice to, I don't know, move this car left or right, but we can see how far before you even know that there's a choice to come, can you predict your choice? So you don't even know when they're going to be an intersection, but you already know that when you see one, you're going to go, I think, what right in this case. And then if we ask you, hey, tell me when you think you chose to go right, you will give me an answer. You can say, I don't know, 3 seconds ago. But we know that there was a big gap between when you knew, when I knew, and when your brain told you that you know. And now we can again ask the question, can I come in between and change things? Okay, I want to end by showing you the coolest thing, because I want to tie it also to something you can take home. So, okay, I hope I convinced you that it's important to look at the brain and to understand. This. Straight to the last thing I'm saying, which is this. Okay. So, important to look at the brain. The brain codes who we are. Changes to the brain can change who we want to be. And we can even start to know things about what you want before you know it. Those are the learnings so far. Here's the last one and that I'm going to share with you. And then I'm going to go to the inspiring part. The last 2 minutes are inspiring part. For a while, we tried to understand kind of what the brain is for. And people had theories what their brain is for. You probably have one of your own in your own brain. But in the last couple of years, we actually came up with an answer that we think is the one that is true, and it ties nicely to the speakers before me. And it suggests that the brain is basically a big machine to find signal in a noisy environment. Meaning, the brain is a machine that takes a lot of information, it comes in, and finds meaning in it, finds a pattern. And learning is that. Learning is getting a lot of information and finding some signal, some meaning in it that we can actually take forward, feedback in the system, and move with it to make decisions different and better in the future. And we know that because we can start playing with brains and actually see what things we can teach them without you being there to solve the problem for me. Here's what I mean. I said a few minutes ago that the brain sits in a dark place full of water, it's really cold and quiet. The brain somehow also sees the world. We also, in the end, have a version of the world. How does it work? Well, the brain speaks its own language, the language of those pipes that you heard, those activities, but it does have helpers. The brain has eyes, ears, nose, tongue, skin, and those tools take the world and turn it into the language of the brain. And then the brain calls this reality. So our eyes know how to take photonic activity and turn it into the signal of the brain, those spikes, and it goes to the right place of the brain, and the brain calls it seeing. This is what we call reality. And the ears know how to turn a molecular vibration in the air into the side of the brain, and then the brain calls it hearing. And in the brain, everything speaks the same language. It's just that the plug-and-play devices that we have plugged to the brain speak the language of the world and turn it into what we can experience. Now, those devices that we use to scan the world are limited. They're not complete. They're not seeing the world as it is. We know that our eyes can see all of those colors from infrared to ultraviolet, but that's only 1/10 trillionth of what is out there. In the world, there's gamma rays and x-rays and radio waves and microwaves. All of those exist as in they're part of our reality. We can sense them using microwaves or using x-ray devices in hospitals, but we continue to see them. In fact, out of every person in the room right now, there's a pocket with rays of light that go to a cell tower somewhere at the top, and they exist because you have devices that can actually use them, but you don't really sense them. You can kind of pass your hands through those a rays of light, and it won't interfere in many ways. Like, it's just there, but you don't really sense it. But if there was a bat in this room, the bat would actually fly between those rays, because it's part of its reality. It would actually see them, and it would fly between them, because it's there for you. Because bats have a different way to sense the world. They have echolocating eyes, and they just use sonars to basically see what's out there, and they go between those things. They don't see things that you see, but they see other things that you don't see. Now, if you look at the brain of a bat in the inside, and the brain of a human on the inside, the cells are the same. We use the same machinery to make a brain, just that they fold it differently and have different plug-in devices to translate the world into the brain. Which means that if you take the eyes of the bat and plug them into the human brain, we can actually get the ability to see those rays of reception, like you see them, we actually see them in reality. If we take X-ray devices and apply them to the brain, we'll have our brain learn to do that. And we don't just think about it in science fiction, because we know we can only do that in reality. So up to now, it sounds like science fiction, but here's examples that came for the last decade. People who were deaf from birth up to 10 years ago were basically doomed to not hear in their life. But now, thanks to advances in what we call sensory addition, we can build a cochlear implant, a device that does what the ear does, but also knows how to translate the vibrations in the air to the language of the brain. And the brain of people who were deaf before, within 7 months, learned to hear. You first blast their brain with information from the world, and within 7 months, their brain, without any guidance from you, learns to do the Fourier transform of the signal and just come with meaning that we call hearing. So about 7 months, it takes a brain to just be bombarded with information and start to know how to call these sounds, human, a car, the wind, and so on. And it's not surprising, we all did it in our life when we were born. We were all born with a brain that knows how to grasp the world, but no one actually taught us as kids, hey, this is the color blue and this is the color yellow. We kind of sat there, our brain was bombarded through our eyes with different things, and because some things were meaningful and useful, we learned to focus on them and see them better, and over the course of a few months, we learned to see and hear and smell and sense the world through our skin. So our brain knows within a very short time how to take something complex and find meaning in it. And once we understood this in the last decade, we started to ask the question, what else can we feed to the brain and have the brain do the work of finding meaning in it? And this is why I do business. A colleague of mine ran this cool experiment where he built this full body wearable device that has pressure sensors all over it that kind of change the temperature and pressure in your body. And he gives subjects, people like you and I, this vest that they put and a tablet. And he turns on the vest, and then they feel something in the back of their brain, and then say, it's back of their shoulder and the chest. And he says, okay, now you felt some kind of pressure. There are two arrows on the tablet. One says go left, one says go right. Make a choice, left or right. The guy says, I have no idea. Doesn't, never mind, just make a guess. Okay, right. Correct. You earn $1. Another trial. We turn it on, you feel some pressure, this time it's in your leg, and it's a little bit colder in your neck. And then he says again, make a choice, left or right. And you say, left. Incorrect. You lost $1. For the next half an hour, you just keep feeling things in your body, making decisions. And at some point, people start getting better. They start saying, you know, every time I feel this, I kind of go right, every time I feel that I can go left, and it sounds right, and it starts to align, so they make more money. In fact, after about 45 minutes of playing this game, they are better than chance. As if they start doing a good job and kind of knowing what to do. They also come up with an answer, they come up with an explanation, like we always do humans, we come up with a story, hey, it's always this when I go left, it's always that when I go right, they come up with an answer. But more than anything, they beat themselves when they actually know what they're doing. What they're doing actually is that this feeling that they feel in their body isn't just random. It was the S&P 500 turning into a feeling in their body, and what they do is they make buy and sell choices for a year ago. So they make decisions on what to buy and what to sell. And they do better than themselves when they make a possible coin, of course, but also if you tell them, this is S&P 500, and these are choices, make a decision to buy or sell. They're not doing a good job, because it's too complex, the world. Too many information, too many dimensions. But when you translate it into a feeling in the body, and you move it away from thinking into a feeling, people actually can use that to do a better job. Now, it's not working always. It works only with problems that are really, really big, and where the brain is not good in perceiving everything. But the reality is that many of the problems that we deal with right now are like that. Many of the problems in the world are multidimensional, with tons of data, that we, as thinkers, are having a hard time seeing all the dimensions. But our brain is really good in taking all information and finding meaning in it. So what we call sensory vision is the idea that we can actually feed the brain information in forms that the brain knows how to pulse without the need for us to understand what's going on there. And with enough training, you have the feedback that tells you right or wrong, you will actually start to see meaning in it and know how to solve that. And this is one of the new uses of neuroscience in the real world. Complex marketing problems, trading decisions, flight cockpits with tons of gadgets, all of those could be potentially problems that the brain can solve without you thinking. And this ties nicely to what I told you in this talk, because in the brain you have, if you want, two components. One system is the smaller one, the slower one, and the one that we live life through, the thinking one that kind of tries to explain reality, and one much bigger, much more complex, much faster, and relies on hundreds of years of evolution, thousands or millions of years of evolution, knows how to do things in a different way. We spend most of our life with the one that we understand better and we can work with. We ignore, for many ways, the other one. And right now, neuroscience is giving us access to the other one, but also proofs that it knows a lot more than we think it knows, and the more we are able to translate information into it, we can do a better job. And here is the inspiring part of the end of it. So it's really hard. I'm asking you basically to trust neuroscientists and tell you that other parts of the brain know better than you, and that you don't really know what you want, and that you make mistakes, and it knows better, and you would say, okay, well, A, it's hard, and B, I don't know what to do there. So I created it out, and I'm gonna end with something that I find inspiring when I think about that. And I think if you just take this from this talk, it will take you a big step further towards starting to rely on this other idea. And more than anything, I ask you to just keep an eye on this field, because it's new. And it's relatively young, and it's still immature. There's a lot of mistakes there, there's a lot of problems there. But the point for this talk isn't that you should leave this room and say, okay, now I'm gonna change career, or I'm gonna hire a neuroscientist to actually do everything for me. I want you to just keep looking at those, you know, links that your grandmother sends you every now and then that says solution for Alzheimer. Now, look at those, because what we're doing right now, neuroscientists, is trying better and better to actually offer you tools. And if you just keep an eye on those tools, I believe that in the next decade they will become useful and practical for you guys. We already have a few of those. Some of the people in the room work on using those to actually solve problems of how we learn better, or how we can engage you in content better, or how we can understand you make decisions. I'm happy to talk about those afterwards in private, but the point is that the tools are getting better by the months. Every month there's a new paper with a new idea, and I want you to keep an eye on those, because it will be part of your life in the years to come. The inspiring ending. Every time I think about the fact that there's in our brains more than one character, and they vie for dominance, and we only see the outcome, and we don't really know how to explain it, I find it really hard to do something about it. Here is what helps me, and I hope it will help you. It's a story from 408 years ago. May, I think, was when it happened. So, really to the date. When Galileo Galilei pointed his telescope to the moons of Jupiter, and tried to observe their orbits. And it didn't work the way he planned for it to work. His equation, so to speak, didn't really have equations, he just had observations, didn't align with what he saw in his telescope. And the only way to explain how the moons of Jupiter work was to actually change the entire heliocentric system, to put the sun in the center and to put the Earth as the third planet from the center. Now, this to him felt like a dethronement of humankind. What does it mean that we're just one more planet out of many and we're not the center of the world? It really was a difficult idea for him to grasp it, but the equations didn't align with the reality, and he went with the reality. And in the course of his changes, he actually accepted the fact that we're just one more planet out of many and lived his life with this different system that it took us a few years later than him to accept. But in the 400 years that followed Galileo Galilei, we understood that he was right, but also we understood that if you align the universe this way, you see much more of it. You see the far reaches of the universe, and you understand a lot more about the world. We suddenly saw other galaxies, other universes, other galaxies, other planets, other experiences of the world that we didn't have before, just because we accepted the fact that we're not the center of the universe. Now, in the same way, in the last 10 years, neuroscientists are giving you the same idea. They're saying, in your own head, you're not the center. There are other voices there that drive who you are, and you're just kind of coming after the fact. Now, it's really hard for us to accept, the same way it was hard for him to accept, that we're not the center of our own universe. But if we were to do this shift and start understanding that maybe there's other voices that drive the wagon, and that we're not really necessarily the center of this little galaxy we call us, will understand the most interesting thing in the universe, which is us. Thank you.